Well, hey, Jet people, welcome to the shop. It is a Thursday, and a few people have commented recently that they're quite concerned about ever riding on an airplane because those little tiny weak little things that lock the turbine blades in place. We're talking about the pins for the J47, the lock strips for the Orenda, and the lock tabs for the J79-LM1500, and very similar to the core of the CF6, the LM2500. All right, we're gonna take a look at some of those. I don't have all of them here today, but some engines have much more secure turbine locking systems than others. Why is that? Why do highly successful jet engines have what seem to be the weakest, lamest, littlest mosquito legs holding the turbine blades in place? Because the turbine blades are under enormous forces, both centrifugally and you could call it axially or bending wise, because they're fixed at the root and they're pushed on by the gas forces to go back towards the back of the engine. So I call that a bending force. It's also produced by an axial flow of gases. But those two forces I just mentioned, they actually lock the blades in place. So the stronger you blow against the blade, the harder it is locked into place. And the faster you spin the wheel, within limits, the harder it's locked in place. So the very forces that are trying to dislodge, in terms of the axial gas flow forces, those forces are, the stronger they get, the more it locks in place. It's amazing. So I've tried over the years to come up with a way to describe what's going on. What are the blade locks for anyway? You've seen us put them in the recent video called Turbine Blading, which apparently is pretty popular. That's of the Orenda. Well, no, that's the J47. There's also a turbine buildup. I think it's turbine buildup. Maybe it's turbine blading. It's for the Orenda, where we squash the lock strips in place. I don't have any footage of the J79, and I don't have a lock strip in here today. If I do, I can't find it. But that's okay, I'll show you a couple examples. Okay folks, we're zooming in to a toonie. Hang on, there's a Canadian $2 coin. And that is a J47 blade lock device. It's a tiny little roll pin. Right there, that thing. This is a high pressure or stage one turbine disc blade lock strip from an Orenda. This is an 8,000 horsepower engine. This is a 10,000 horsepower engine. And for size, we've got the Toonie. All right, I realize half of my audience is American, so this is a Canadian quarter. It's the same size as an American quarter. Look at that, eh? Look at that, eh? Hey, there you go, eh? There you go, eh? There's some Canadian money for you. All right, so these little things, they really can't hold much. Takes a bit of a whack of a hammer to break this thing in half, and it takes next to nothing to bend these tabs. I can't do it by hand right now, but you can see how it's 1/100,000 of an inch thick, so 0.1 inches. It's very not hugely strong. Yes, this one's been removed carefully. See how it's kind of bent there? Anyway, there's a zip tie. A zip tie would work just as well, except it would melt. Here's a piece of aluminum welding rod, it would also melt. These things work at around somewhere close to 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. There you go, those are your lock strips. Bing bang. And now we're gonna go to the test cell where Electron Bill has a J79 jet engine running on propane, because we've stripped out the stock fuel manifold and nozzles and put in a gaseous system, got her idling. Gonna crank her up to maximum power, bring her back down, and then I have a little demonstration in the back of the engine where we will explore just what the turbine lock strips are needed for if the blades are locked in place under operation. There's no way they're gonna move when the engine is making power.
Okay. just shut down the engine. We're going to wait until we hear the turbine blades clicking. And at that speed, that's the only time the locking devices are doing anything. That means the blades aren't locked in place by cocking in their machined fir tree slots. So those little tiny clips, pins, or tabs, the only time they do anything is about 100 RPM or lower. They're just purging the excess fuel from the fuel line there. You can hear how fast the engine's turning, i.e. not very. Still no clicking. Still no clicking. That once per rev tick is probably a slight contact with a blade tip shroud. Okay, we can start to hear the blades moving now. Start to hear it. Okay, this is the speed at which the turbine blade locking devices come into play. They're keeping the blades from rattling around and maybe moving out of their slots. But this, on the tachometer in the airplane, this would be reading zero. Let's go see if we can see the engine speed readout. Okay, so you can see on our computer screen readout, our electromechanical RPM engine rotor speed meter said zero, and now we can hear the turbine blade locks working. You can actually see the turbine disc is moving at about, 10 or 20 RPM, basically nothing. That's the only time that the blade locks do anything. And if the engine speed is at this and we have an earthquake, that would also help. Thanks.
The turbine blades, when they become loose, loose enough to move in their slots, you can hear them rattling and clinking. That's basically gravity. They're flopping down this way and this side, and they're flopping down this way. And so gravity is making them click around in their mounts as it rolls. And you can hear that in that clickety, clickety, clickety. But when the engine's turning 50, 30, 20, 10 RPM, the aerodynamic forces on the turbine blades are nothing because there's no compression happening. At 10 RPM, the compressor's doing nothing. So there's no gas flow going by the blades, pushing them in an axial position, which is how they would slide out. They slide axially in their groove. And that's how you get them out. We've talked about the subtleties of turbine blade removal before. Probably in the recent J47 removing blades, there's got to be one with the Arenda. That's the previous playlist. And there's probably others. Okay, where was I? Oh yeah, and turning at 10 or 20 RPM, centrifugal force is basically insignificant. There is some there, there's always some there, no matter how slow it's going. So long as it's moving, even a clock has centrifugal force, but it's so small, it's negligible. We call it zero. So at 10, 20 RPM, there's nothing, nothing on the blades. So they're just sitting there, they're rattling back and forth. That's when the locking devices are doing their job, because let's just say for whatever reason, something would rattle one way or the other a little bit each time, and after hundreds and hundreds of flights, it might advance or move backwards a millimeter or two, and then it starts to get to be a problem where it might contact other non-rotating parts of the engine. You just don't want it to start to migrate. But as far as transmitting power to the turbine wheel from the turbine blade, the locking strip, the locking tab, the locking pin does absolutely nothing.
On the back end of an LM1500 burning propane in Fort St. John, BC, demonstrating blade locks. Thanks for watching.